Welcome back to Inside the Box. I'm your host, Joanna Lee, and today we will launch the second episode of the series commemorating Asian Heritage Month. Today, I'm pleased to welcome my guest, Chinese-Canadian harpist Nathania Koh. Nathania is the first and only professional Konghou player in Canada and has recently completed her master's in performance at the University of British Columbia. Today, we will discuss her role in bridging the cultural gap between Western and Eastern music scene. Welcome, Nathania. It is so good to have you.
Thank you for inviting me.
So, I was wondering, how did you get into music? Did you begin with classical training?
Yes, so I started at the age of five. I played the piano. And I did a bit of saxophone before I transitioned into French horn for a grade 7 band. And then I continued all the way until grade 12, playing the French horn in band, wind ensemble. And I also participated in BCMEA, which is the British Columbia Music Educators Association, and I played first horn there for a year.
Amazing. So, what is the Konghou, and can you give me a demonstration?
Sure.
Hey guys, so I have the two instruments over here, the Western harp and the Konghou. As you can see, they both have pedal mechanisms on the bottom, so you step on it to change your pitches from flat to natural to sharp. And the tuning pins are both located at the top. However, the soundboard placements are different. For the Western harp, the soundboard is placed on the bottom underneath the strings, and for the Konghou, it is placed in between the two strings, two sets of strings. So as you can see here, the harp has one set of strings, and later I'll be showing you the Konghou close up. There are bridges in between. As you can see, it's holding the strings up, so it's putting tension on the strings. So you can pitch bend, you can bend the pitches on the strings. So if you bend on the left side, the pitch off the right string will go up. And for the instruments, their string materials are different. For the Western harp, there are three types of string material. So the bass region has wire strings, metal wire strings, and the middle region is gut strings, made of guts. And the top register has nylon strings, whereas this one is the same all throughout. It's made with metal wire strings wrapped with nylon around it, so it has a pretty rich sound, but it's a little bit more, it has a metallic timbre to it. So I will be showing you the Konghou and its extended techniques. Hey everyone, so I'm here with my Konghou. As you can see, there are two sets of strings, one on each side. And with that, you can achieve stuff like pitch bending. So they're tuned to the same note on both sides. Oh, sorry, I meant F sharp. Yeah, and you can bend the pitches by pressing in on the left string and plucking on the right one. And tremolo, let me tune this to a chromatic scale with the pedals. So, this on the left and then plug on the right. I like how you don't really interfere with the other strings. Sometimes, you know, when you have one set of strings, you're trying to get in between the notes and my fingers get stuck. But, you know, when you're looking through the strings or through the little hole over here to look at the other side, it really takes a lot of time to adjust to this instrument because, you know, it's like a lot of strings in different angles, yeah, it's really hard to adjust at first, but yeah, I've been playing with it for a few years, so thankfully I could memorize the strings on the right hand. And with the different timbre, you know, you can achieve different timbre with different regions. So let's say if I played a verse of this Mekong style piece. Mm-hmm. collected with my nails near the bridge, so I lowered the position of where I pluck. I was exploring some different kind of new sounds on the instrument, and I discovered that I was writing for a picking opera style piece for composition homework, and I discovered that this region sounded like picking opera percussion. Yeah, it's fun to play with, and the top part, really light and crisp. So there are all these like different techniques. There are also some that are similar to the harp. No, harmonics, light and crisp. And the bass notes resonate a lot. The resonance goes on for a while because of the soundboard in the middle section. Yeah, so I guess mainly the biggest difference or biggest technical difference with the two instruments is one, you have to adjust to the two set of strings, and pitch bending. When they made the Konghou, they took in the shape of the pipa, so if I tilted it a bit, you can see the soundboard is shaped like a pipa, and the bridges on the side are similar to that of a Chinese guzheng or Chinese zither, and the overall shape is similar to its sister instrument, the Western harp, and the pedal mechanisms work the same way, except it functions on both sides. There are metal strings with nylon. This type of string is actually the type you find inside a piano. I really think that this is like, rather than calling it a Chinese harp, I like to call it a world harp, because it incorporates a lot of different elements and it's suitable to play all types of different music from different cultures and backgrounds. So yeah, I hope you all enjoyed. Thank you.
Now, can you tell me more about the history of Konghou?
Sure. So, China's native Konghou is actually horizontal. It's similar to a dulcimer and a zither. It looks like a hybrid between the pipa and the guzheng or Chinese zither. And during the era of the Silk Road, Persia and Myanmar both introduced the vertical Konghou, which looks exactly the same as the ancestor of the harp, thus making the two instruments sister instruments. So in the Han dynasties, that range from 206 BC to 220 AD, the traces of the Konghou being existent in China is evident. So this instrument is often used for religious ceremonies, and it is thought to have the ability to communicate with the deities in heaven. You can see a lot of paintings of the Konghou in Dunhuang cave walls, and there are even poems that write about this instrument. Like in the poem Peacock Flies the Southeast, you can see the lives of girls during ancient times. At the age of 13 and 14, they learn how to sew and weave, and by the age of 15, they must learn the Konghou. It's similar to modern-day piano. It's extremely popularized, especially during the Tang Dynasty. Unfortunately, this instrument had been extinct for the past 400 years, and that was during the fall of the Ming Dynasty and transitioning into the Qing Dynasty. However, I've talked to a musicologist from China, and she informed me that it was recorded in books that people really can't get their hands on. They're locked in these like libraries. But she did tell me about how there is a legend that says the emperor loved this instrument so much that he made it forbidden for commoners to play, and it was imprisoned in this imperial palace. And after transitioning into a different dynasty, you know, it was covered by, you know, war, and it was never to appear again. So she told me that actually the emperor banned all arts, music, and prostitution, because in the hierarchy back then, musicians and artists were viewed as the lowest ranking people in society. So he banned the Konghou along with that as well. That is why its sound was never heard again afterwards. China started a revival for this instrument in the early 1920s. Historians, instrument makers, and archaeologists and musicians, they all gathered together to look at cave wall paintings, remains dug up from tombs along the Silk Road, and they went to Japan and Korea to look at the, you know, what remains. So there's the Kugo and the Gopu, and they took all this information and turned it into a modern Konghou. So they made a hypothesis on what the Konghou would have looked like right now. So if you look at the Western harp, it has a full pedal mechanism, one set of strings, and you can, you know, change the keys from flat to natural to sharp. And this is what they did with the modern Konghou, as you see here. This was accomplished in 1984, it looks like its sister instrument, the Western harp, as you can see the shape and strings. However, as I have talked about in the previous video that I showed, that I demonstrated, there are two sets of strings. So it took them almost 60 years to revive this instrument and to turn it into, you know, something that it would have become.
Amazing. Thank you for sharing. That's a very thorough background of the instrument. Speaking of the Konghou and the Kugo, what are the similarities and difference between those two instruments and the Konghou?
Well, they're just, they're the same words, but you're pronouncing them differently since, you know, there's Japanese, Chinese. So Konghou, Kugo, and Konghou, they're the same instrument. However, if we look at Kugo players in Japan, their Kugo resembles that of the Tang Dynasty. So in the Tang Dynasty, you would see Konghous shaped like the modern Kugo, or what you see they play today. And the Konghou in Korea, it resembles that from the Song Dynasty. It's taller, it has more strings, the range is wider. So there's not much difference, it's just a different name, but you can see how they're preserved in Japan, the Tang Dynasty Konghou, and in Korea, the Song Dynasty Konghou.
Let's circle back to that time where you and I collaborated in that Korean opera, Chuyang. And let's talk about what sound you're sort of trying to imitate on your Konghou.
Well, when Jason first contacted me about his project, he wanted me to play the Western harp to mimic the kayu, which is the Korean zither. And I told him I actually play the Konghou as well, and I explained to him what it is. So we arranged a meeting. I brought him to the harp practice room in UBC, and I showed him all the techniques on the Konghou. And I told him how we both knew that, or we both thought that it was more suitable to replicate the sound of the kayagu. And there were vibratos, we can play with picks, and there were tremolos. So yeah, we used the Konghou to replicate the kayagun during his pangsori styled opera.
Amazing. Can you demonstrate how it would be played as a kayakum and how it would be played as a konghou?
Hey everyone, so I will attempt to play or mimic the sound of the kayagum and the gonghu on here. Let's start with the kayagum. I use the back of my nails to pluck, and it gives a more brittle and metallic effect. The gonghu, however, is plucked with the fingers, and it has a wider range than the kayagum. However, the materials of the strings are different, so the sound might be different than the original, but this is my attempt to recreate the sound. I plucked a bit more lightly because the strings are much more fragile than the konghou. That's my attempt to recreate the two instruments.
Wow, thank you so much for sharing that. That was very lovely. I was wondering, from your experience in the Gamelan ensemble, how does the konghou compare?
They're definitely different. The konghou is more of a solo instrument and we can play in chamber ensembles, but for gamelan, it was pretty intense for me, but I'm so grateful that I took the course. First day I walked into the room, you know, I see all these instruments. They kind of resemble Korean hot pots, and I took a picture and sent it to my mom. They look amazing. But then, Dr. Tenzer handed out earplugs, and so he's like, beware, it's loud. I didn't wear them, and oh my god, that first sound that we hammered down, Jesus Christ, it killed my earphones. But then, you know, after a while, you know, with the earplugs, you finally get used to it. But it requires teamwork. There's no individual, no solo. It's a sound, it's music that you produce together. And I really resonate with it because gamelan music in Indonesia is used during religious ceremonies and also during, you know, rituals and all these events. So I resonate with this because the konghou also is viewed as sacred music. And at first, you know, I know you have perfect pitch, so it's hard for you to, it might be hard for you because, you know, every single metal is, every single gamelan instrument, they're not in tune. They're very not in tune, and the one you have next to you is probably in a totally different tune, but they tune it by, they tune it by toning down, like, the metal and just kind of, you know, what do you call it? Shaving it. Yeah, so they shave the metal and you have to take a hammer and you have to stop the note, the previous note that you played, to make sure that the notes don't mix together. And you really have to listen to the person next to you because the melodies are interweaving. And some people are playing syncopated rhythms and others are playing, you know, on the beat. So it really is, it's going to throw you off at first. There are no scores, you can't look at sheet music, and you have to memorize every single line. So you really can't miss a rehearsal. If you do, then lots of catching up to do. For the full 2 hours, you're just like hammering away. And once you get to full speed, you really need to have precision and perfection when you're playing. Because if you play the wrong note, or if you start forgetting your notes, you're going to throw the whole ensemble off. And it's gonna become a chain wreck. We've done that in rehearsals, but thankfully not during our concert. I really learned how to collaborate with others. I learned to listen for others, and I learned to trust my teammates when we're playing. And that is really valuable to me, especially when I you know, the Konghou is mainly a solo instrument, and I've never really done too much ensemble work. So that really got me started with, you know, collaborations and playing music with others.
Thank you for sharing. I just thought of something you can name your ensemble. It's called the 12-tone ensemble.
Right?
That's the
yeah.
That being said, speaking of world music, can you tell me about your experience with the Silk Road Ensemble and your encounters with Yo-Yo Ma?
Yeah, for sure. Well, in 2017, I went to Indianapolis to attend Global Musician Workshop, which was hosted by the Silk Road Ensemble. We get to choose three instructors out of the whole ensemble, and I was assigned, I chose Bassam Saba. He is the New York Arabic Orchestra. He's the establisher of the New York Arabic Orchestra. And Sandeep Das is the tabla player, and I took lessons from him a few times. I got myself a pair of tabla. They're very fun Indian drums. And also Uman, the pipa player, whom I now work for. So I'll be translating for them during events in China. We go to television interviews, I'm her assistant, and then I do video editing, audio editing for her. So it's great to see how many world music festivals and events are happening around, like, globally. So I'm really glad that, you know, all these cultural instruments or ethnic instruments are, you know, coming out. And she suggested that I go to an event in Guangzhou, China, called YMCG, and that's where Yo-Yo is there to teach classes. You know, it's for stringed instruments, but unfortunately not harp, so I didn't get to go as a performer. But I was there to volunteer, and I learned a lot through that. So the first time I saw Yo-Yo, I was in a hotel lobby picking them up with a bus to take them to camp. He is everyone's idol, I know, but he's also, like, one of my idols. And he is the nicest person ever, because he was standing at the door of the bus, greeting everyone, making sure all his friends were on the bus and comfortable before he went on the blast. And he would be greeting them row by row. And he saw me, and he was like, "Hi, I'm Yo-Yo." I'm like, "Yes, I know." And he was thanking me for, you know, volunteering for this and giving them my time and, you know, picking them up, sending them back. So we had parties every few days. I was drinking a beer, and Yo-Yo was also drinking a beer and talking to people, and I approached him because during that week I saw them rehearse. I saw him rehearse with his chamber group, and I also saw him practice alone. It was phenomenal. He was playing Davidoff. When they were rehearsing, Yo-Yo would be blurting out words rather than, you know, saying how loud or how soft they should play. He blurted out words, and they instantaneously knew what to play. When he said dancing goblins, everyone started hunching over, you know, dancing, and it was a little bit grotesque, but it was so effective. And he would be yelling out adjectives like desolation, and then everyone would be like mourning, and, you know, their instruments would be crying, and it was such a great experience. So when we were, you know, when we were at the reception or party, whatever you call it, it's more of a party, everyone was like dancing, getting high. So I asked him, how does this musicality come out so naturally? And he told me, you really have to assign stories to the movements and passages. When you apply your own experience onto these music, you really can feel them. And when you have a mental image shown, then you know how to play. So ever since then, you know, I'll be directing a movie in my mind, so I'll know the plot of the story. So when you're reading notations, you're really, it's like reading a storybook. and you'll be assigning words or images to these measures and passages, and it just naturally comes out. Although it really does take a lot of practice, so he's done it for so many years, and that's why he's so great. But I found that this method really helps with me trying to express the musicality or trying to, you know, it's like bonding with the instrument as well, to let the instrument tell what you're trying to say.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing that. Let's circle back to your educational roots. I was wondering what differences you found in your education in China versus Canada, and were there limitations?
Well, there definitely were limitations. Because I grew up in Canada, we're a really free country. When I went to China, it was a totally different world to me. They're really strict on protocols and policies. I once was late for class. They put my name on the bulletin board. I drew a smiley face next to my name, and I had to write a 5-page essay to apologize to the school. That's how strict they were. So with the music, they really require you to practice and build a really firm foundation. But the thing was that a lot of people say, it's a controversial topic, a lot of people say that they're mass-producing robots that play perfectly. No wrong notes, exact pitches, perfect rhythm. It kind of is like that, but it really depends on the teacher. So my teacher would encourage me to, you know, practice my vibratos evenly, do the tremolos at a certain speed, do your gliss or your glides. You have to bend the pitch to a certain extent, you bend the pitch to a certain note. So I felt kind of like I could not express my own emotions or feelings through that, but I could see afterwards that my teacher was actually trying to cram 10 years of foundation into that 1 year. So I was not like other kids who, you know, started their instrument when they were 5 or 8. I started this instrument when I was 18. So it was quite horrifying, but you know, I'm grateful that she did that to me so I could have a better foundation. And I guess in Canada, when I came all the way to Vancouver, I came back home to Vancouver, and I got into UBC Masters for harp performance. You know, it's suddenly like you're set free from prison and you're given all these options. You know, I'd be flipping through pages and pages of courses that you can take. And in China, they want you to focus more on practice. So they would set, you know, these mandatory courses that you have to take, and you can only have like 2 electives to take. And it's like martial arts, which I really wanted to take, but I never could register for it. There's like music in Italian, music terms for French, or, you know, there were some of these courses. But UBC, I got into contemporary players, I got into composition, there's Gamelan, there's Chinese ensemble, you can learn about electronic music. These are options that we have in UBC, but I've never seen them in China. So it really is, like, I like it here. There's so much freedom. You can experiment with different things. And it really made me, it kind of made me establish like more knowledge on the things that were missing from China. Though in China, there are things that we don't like here, like Chinese history or, you know, historical like musicology or things like that. So yeah, it's nice to experience 2 different worlds.
Thank you so much for sharing that. I was wondering, can you tell me more about your role as a performer-composer?
Yeah, well, when I started taking composition, I found out that I was more passionate about, I grew more passionate about composition. I could see a musical hierarchy in China, especially because, you know, there'd be aunties and uncles asking me, so what do you major in? And I say, Chinese traditional music. And they'd be like, oh. You know, it's like an awkward oh. It's not like a, oh, good for you. But it's like, oh, why? You know? But I really think that music is a universal language. Without culture, I don't believe there would be music. A lot of people are trying to think Western music, where the classical musicians are so classy and, you know, high level. But I believe the same for folk musicians as well, or traditional or ethnic musical players. You know, the ceremony system that was established 3,000 years ago, it's as humanity or the Chinese progressed into civilization, they believe that music and courtesy is the most important thing. So it was viewed as highest regard during that time. Music is really sacred. It was like a holy, it was like the instruments were really holy and pure. So, you know, as music developed, I really think without culture, we really can't do so. But culture, the cultural aspect in music lost its significance. We rarely talk about it now. You know, it's more about looking at the notes, looking at the rhythm, fortissimo, piano, all these like musical terms. But, you know, I think I often like to research the history of the pieces that I am working on, just so I can have a better understanding of music at that time and how people, you know, what people's lives were like, so you can, you know, be more, you know, connected to the music that you're playing. And I really don't want people to feel like, you know, being a musician is impractical and futile, because quite a lot of comment I get from Chinese adults. Like, they're always talking about how, like, oh, why don't you become a doctor? You got into UBC engineering. Why did you give that up just to, you know, practice like music? You can be a doctor and make lots of money. But to me, I'm holding on to my roots, and I was born in Canada, but my parents were pretty traditional and I had a traditional upbringing. So I can speak Chinese, I can kind of write Chinese, and I could read Chinese. So I just voyaged back all the way to China just so I can find my roots. And once you discover that how important, you know, culture is in music, you really want to bring it out more, you want to advocate for it. So when I got into composition, I feel like I need to merge all these, you know, elements from the East and the West. Music has no boundary. There is no hierarchy in music. You know, we're all equal. We can produce beautiful music with instruments from all around the world. We don't have to limit ourselves, right? So I really want people to know how much power music has. We can have people speaking different languages sitting in the same room. You play them a song and they can all cry. So that's the beauty of music. Or you can play something joyful and everyone will cheer up. So I really do think that music has a lot of significance in history and in human civilization. So that's why I got into composition as well.
Amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that. So since this is Asian Heritage Month, how can we honor it? And as musicians, what roles would we play?
For musicians, I see a lot of collaborations online, and I'm really thankful for how technology progressed to, you know, the state. Like, we can see you and I are interviewing, or we're talking to each other through, you know, Zoom, and a lot of people, there are lots of platforms where musicians can collaborate and work together, even, you know, remotely, even without being together. So right now I would encourage musicians to work together and, you know, show pieces from your hometown. I see a lot of people baking and cooking food, you know, you can post those on there and remember to share the recipe so I can look at it. But it really is a time where people are stuck at home, we're surfing the internet, and you can teach others about your background, of your family's culture, through different, a variety of styles, either through playing music, by cooking traditional food, or you know, talking about history or legends from your hometown. It really is fascinating. I watch a lot of these videos, and I'm pretty sure a lot of audience out there will enjoy that as well. So yeah, record yourself doing something fun.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this wraps it up. Thank you so much for joining us and having this conversation with me. And for our audience, thank you for joining us. We have a special clip of Nathania and I performing the Korean folk tune Arirang on the violin and Konghou for you. Please enjoy. Don't forget to hit the like button, notification bell, and subscribe.
Thank you for having me.
Bye.